Good morning.
Good morning. Good to see you all here today on the third Sunday of Advent, and our people on YouTube and Facebook, good to see you today also. Come and take a few moments as things play and prepare ourselves for
Thank you. Shepherds in the nearby fields, watching over their flocks. God sent his angel to them, and the light of God's glory made the night as bright as day. They were terrified. So the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I have come to give you good news of great joy for everyone. Tonight in Bethlehem, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This is
Amen.
Everybody here today. It's a nice sunny day today, a lot different than yesterday. So I'm glad to see you here. My mom's feeling a little under the weather, so hey mom, hope you're feeling better. We'll call you in a little bit. All right, we're ready to go. We're going to do a couple songs today that we've done before. The second one, Joy to the World, it's got a little twist in it, so don't just be rocking on like you normally do, because there's some surprises in that one. So follow the words. You ready? Go ahead, team. Stand if you want to stand. You have brought to the world. Lord, we ask that you be with us all. Keep us safe. Keep us healthy. Bring us back again next week. Which in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Is getting fat.
My beautiful youngest child graduated college.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! The bills have ended.
With a dual major and a positive outlook.
Sunday and enjoyed a wonderful rendering.
boy, of course. So we celebrate that.
That's wonderful news. Thank you, Mark.
Also, thanks to everybody that contributed to and showed up for the live nativity this year. We didn't have the holiday walk to draw a crowd, but we brought in a good crowd as well. So we were glad everybody that joined us was able to join us for that special event.
And I want to thank all the animals that came. The animals that could not be with us.
He was in our hearts. Oh, no.
God, our hearts turn toward you, and we offer our praise and our worship and our thanksgiving for so many blessings. We thank you for a building to meet in, for the freedom to worship without government interference, for the gift of Jesus the Christ child, who would be born as one of us and who would die for our sins. We are grateful for this community of people who love you and long to serve you. We thank you for those gathered and those within the internet connections. And we ask your blessings upon each one. We lift up to you those war-torn countries who know religious persecution. We lift up to you our brothers and sisters in Kentucky who have been devastated with over 70 deaths. We ask that you would comfort your people. We pray for healing for our church members who are in need of it, and we ask especially for your divine intervention in Pastor Ken. Not only healing from the COVID, but healing from ALS. We ask you, Lord Jesus, to watch over our congregation, to bring comfort to Queen's family in Bonji's passing, to watch over those who have medical issues and concerns, touch their hearts and lives. We thank you, Lord God, that you love us with an
long for us to be fully committed and to know the joy that comes from belonging to you alone. We thank you, Lord God, for your many mercies that are without end. We ask that you would hover here among us, touching our spirits and our souls with your presence, with your love, and with your joy. Watch over our congregation and this service, and may all that is spoken, all that is shared, all that is sung bring glory to your holy name. O God, you are a God worthy of our praise, and we come in humble adoration, humble obedience to you this morning. Speak to our hearts through your servant, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable, yes, pleasing in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Scripture reading today is from Mark chapter 10, verses 13 through 16. One day some parents brought their children to Jesus so he could touch and bless them, but the disciples scolded the parents for bothering them. When Jesus saw what was happening, he was angry with his disciples. He said to them, "Let the children come to me and don't stop them, for the kingdom of God belongs to those who are like these children. I tell you the truth, anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter." Then he took the children in his arms, place his hands on their heads and bless them.
Thank you, Brian. Waiting
long sermons and I've shared a lot of Bible studies, but I always had a hard time with Advent because I know Jesus is born and I'm already in the joy of the moment of the Nativity. And here we are in this preparation of waiting and watching. We know that Christ's child is born in Bethlehem. We know that the joy of God is God with us. We are celebrating that joy. Joy because our Savior is born. Joy because there is expectation of great things that is to happen. Joy that the Savior is with us and the gift that that child brings. A man came to see me a number of years ago who was quite successful. He was an executive with a big firm, and he was climbing the corporate ladder. He had two children, a wife. From all intents and purposes, he looked like the perfect executive. He called to make an appointment with me, and I talked to him, and I said, asked him what the problem was, and he said, "Oh, Pastor, I am miserable." And I looked at him. He was making a large sum of money. He had two very successful children, a son and a daughter, who were doing very well in school. He had a beautiful, accomplished wife. He said, "I'm just empty inside. I'm miserable. I've lost the ability to play with my kids. My marriage is rocky because I spend so many hours working. We don't even talk anymore. We don't have anything in common." He said, "I'm just miserable. I'm cynical and I'm cold and I'm calculating and I'm skeptical about life and I don't like it." I said, "What do you want?" He said, "I want to recover the little child that I lost. The little child within. That satisfaction of living in the moment. That sometimes we think we're mature when we give up that little child, but maturity holds on to that little child, that joyful expectation, that God within us presence, that ability to enter into the present and not be burdened by the past, not be so worried about the future, but to enjoy that which God is doing in us." I think about the Jewish people who are waiting so long for a Savior, and they missed him because he wasn't what they expected or liked. He wasn't a big military leader that would cause all the nations around them, their enemies, to fall. Maybe we miss the blessing that God has given to us because we're expecting one thing and we're overlooking the gift that God is giving us. The joy that Jesus wants us to live with. The expectation that God is with us and will be with us always. Mark 10, we have a wonderful picture of Jesus and the disciples. Jesus is calling the children to come forth, and the disciples noticed him. He had been in this intense discussion with his disciples and the Pharisees, and they were talking about ethics and all kinds of difficult questions. And then the children come running. You know, I just love children because they're not intimidated. They just come on. Come on and play. And the disciples are all officious and stuffy, and they're going to say, "Get away, kids. Jesus doesn't have time for you. He wants the big people, not the short people, not the little people. Go away. You're not important." And can't you just almost hear and feel the disciples? They're puffed up and their chest is out and they're feeling very, very
has done. And he feels very important when he goes around town and he directs traffic. And he's all puffed up. That's kind of what the disciples were looking like as they were pushing away the children from Jesus, who longed to embrace them, to bless them, to be with them. And then that wonderful usher that I knew in a church that is not this one and is not church in Cincinnati, Ohio, but another church that I served, we had a head usher who had been to usher school. And he treated seating people in the Sunday morning worship service as if he was the ringmaster in a circus, or the orchestra leader, the conductor. He was very direct about children and youth being hushed up for making too much noise, because one of the things, children don't come in usually very quietly. They sort of take their own pace and noise factor. And so he got teased so much in that church that they called him head husher. Because he always wanted to hush up the children. And of course, we longed to have the children there, the very lifeblood of the congregation. Jesus loved the children, because they were the next generation. They were the ones who would be the guardians of the good news and of the church. They are the future. And they had a special place in Jesus' heart because they came without guile, with expectation, with open hearts, ready to receive the love that Jesus longed to give them, to bless them, to be with them. He had an open expectation of the disciples that just didn't get, because they thought they were more important than the children. And Jesus knew that the children were vital to the next generation and to what his work would do here on earth, the joy that he longed to have them. We are so blessed to have children among us. Elton Jublood, in The Heart of a Child, said, "We tend to glorify adulthood and wisdom and worldly prudence, but the gospel reverses that. The gospel says the inescapable condition of entrance into the divine fellowship is that we turn and become like a little child, tender, full of wonder, unspoiled on the hard skepticism on which we so often pride ourselves. God has sent the children into the world not only to replenish it, but to serve as a sacred reminder of something precious that we are in danger of losing. The sacrament of a childhood is a continuing education." I was given a book a number of years ago called The Children's Letters to God. It's by Eric Marshall and Stuart Temple. And it's a collection of actual letters that children have written to God, and I just love them. "Dear God, my dad can't start a fire in the grill. Could you make a burning bush in our backyard? Sherry. Dear God, I would like all the bad things to stop happening. Debbie. Dear God, my father is mean sometimes. Please get him not to be, but please, God, don't hurt him. Sincerely, Martin. Dear God, the people in the next apartment fight real loud all the time. Please only let good friends get married. Man. This is one of my favorites. Dear God, I made 25 cents selling lemonade. I will give you some of it someday. Chris." And this is my all-time favorite. "Dear God, I'm giving you a penny to give to a kid poorer than me. Love, Donna. Dear God, a lot of people say bad things with your name in it, but I never do, Helen. Dear God, where did everybody come from? I hope you can explain it better than my father, Ward. And this is Norman. Dear God, did you mean for giraffes to look like that, or was it just an accident? Norman. And then, little Martha, dear God, can you marry food?
Yeah, sadly, yes.
Dear God, I didn't think purple went with orange until I saw the sunset last Tuesday. That was cool, Eugene. And then Herbie writes, dear God, count in your friend Herbie. They are the ingredients of childlikeness, wonder, curiosity, an attitude of dependence and yet trust, an open-mindedness, a humility, and enthusiasm. What a wonderful way. God is so good and gives us so much and gives us love. How tragic it is when we become like the usher, that we are so pompous and so sophisticated and so calculating that we have lost the wonder and joy of the little child within. There are a number of messages from the minds of children, mistakes that they actually learned when they learned some of the scripture. Harriet and Emerson Fosdick, who is a wonderful preacher, called them mistranslations. There are things that children mislearned but accidentally came up with something even better. Our Father, who art in New Haven, how did you know my name? This little girl from New Haven captured in her own way the basic message of the scripture, of the Sermon on the Mount. God is a loving Father who is with us always, wherever we are, in whatever circumstance. And yes, he knows our name. And more importantly, he cares for us. That childlike faith and trust is experienced and expressed in the spiritual. What you gonna do when it comes on night? Trust in God and hold on tight. What you gonna do when your strength gives way? Say, happy Lord, it's judgment day. And then the one who said, our Father, who art in New Haven, how did you know my name? That's exactly the expression. The little boy who learned the 23rd Psalm said, the Lord is my shepherd, that's all that I want. Isn't that a great theology? He learned that God is all that he needed and wanted. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was a theologian in the Nazi concentration camp, once uttered the prayer, Lord, whatever this day brings, may your name be praised. Boy, do we have that kind of trust in God? Do we have that kind of joy even in the concentration camp? Of Bonhoeffer, it was said that he was a giant before men because he was a child before God. And then the wonderful translation, forgive us our trash baskets as we forgive those who trash basket against us. A little girl's rendition of the Lord's Prayer. Henry Kissinger had a problem with reporters going through his trash looking for a story. People, I think, can learn quite a bit about us through our trash. And maybe we all need to pray to forgive us our trash baskets. And finally, the one is, if I should wake before I die. How many of us are frozen in indifference and cynicism and pessimism and have completely forgotten that God is still in control in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of our world, in the
70 people dying in Kentucky. God invites us this Christmas season to come to the manger and to worship Christ. The rich young ruler couldn't follow Jesus because he could not become like a little child. He was too set in his ways, too sophisticated, too calculating. He couldn't believe that God knew his name. He couldn't believe that God's shepherding was all that he needed. He couldn't walk away from his trash basket. He couldn't wake up to the new treasure that Jesus was offering. What about us? Can we use more childlike joy in our lives? Can we become more childlike in our relationship to God? Can we know more joy in living in the moment? Andrew Gillies wrote this two prayers. Last night my little boy confessed to me some childish wrong. Kneeling at my knee, he prayed with tears. Dear God, make me a man like Daddy, wise and strong. I know you can. Then while he slept, I knelt beside his bed and confessed my sins. And prayed with a low bowed head, O God, make me childlike, my child here, pure and guileless, trusting thee with faith sincere. It is my prayer that we would go with childlike joy, for Jesus has come, and we will worship him. Let us pray. Gracious God, speak through my words that we might find joy unspeakable within you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our hymn is The Way in the Manger, and I invite you to stand as we sing. Joy and love and rejoicing for Jesus.
Thank you.